So, Roger, welcome again. Thank you ever so much for your hands.
Well, thank you, Chris, and thank you for the opportunity to lead this seminar. And I think we're quite a cosy group today.
Yeah.
How does workplace leadership affect the spiritual well-being of employees? Well, why are we asking this question? In recent times, there has been a groundswell of feedback from people in management, in business organizations, asking themselves, not just what am I doing here, but why am I here? What am I doing? Why am I doing what I'm doing? And I think it's captured in this quotation from Gregory Ilworth, employees increasingly want an opportunity to express their whole being, physical, intellectual, emotional, and even spiritual sense of a higher purpose and contribution in and from what I'm doing. Even Richard Branson has weighed in with his comment about saying we're here at an exciting frontier here where the boundaries between work and higher purpose are merging into one. I think he's becoming a lot more spiritual in recent times. These needs and opportunities concern well-being, spiritual well-being in particular, as far as our seminar is concerned, and leadership in the workplace. My main specialism is leadership. I'm a visiting professor in the business school, which means I visit from time to time. I'm not a permanent fixture. I've had my time in that respect, I think, in the past. And I've been focusing, particularly from my desk, rather than in the laboratory on the field in recent years, I have to say, on the subject of leadership. And my own review, which is published elsewhere, of leadership is that we have a problem with it, a definition problem. Many definitions focus on the idea of motivating and influencing people. That's what you will see in most definitions of leadership, that phrase, motivating, influencing, inspiring people. I suppose the modern term, the current term for that is getting people engaged, engaging people. Now, this I consider to be an unsatisfactory, inadequate, insufficiently comprehensive concept of leadership for understanding it and developing it and indeed practicing it. My definition, I propose, is that leadership is showing the way. Leaders show the way. And I'm being a little bit etymological here, I have to say, because that's the original meaning of the word. And there's a big debate that goes on about etymology and how, you know, it's a bit passé. Words mean whatever use they're put to in the current time. A bit of a Humpty Dumpty word, if you like, from Alice in Wonderland. But my definition is leadership showing the way and helping or inducing people to pursue it. And I've chosen those words very, very carefully, of course, helping people to pursue the way that they've been shown, inducing people to follow it in some cases, ranging from soft to hard in inducing. And I'm not making any ethical, putting any ethical gloss on that. I'm just saying that's what it is. There's very effective bad leadership in a moral sense, for example. And I have identified six core themes and practices in leadership. Now, just talk about this because this is about workplace leadership. I'm trying to set the scene here. These slides, I hope, will be on the website, and you'll be able to access these for yourself and print them out. So don't worry too much about this. And I'll be succinct, as far as I can be succinct, about a subject I'm very excited about, some of the technicalities here. But I see six core purposes, or core themes and practices. Leadership is about vision. It's about a vision of the future. It's about purpose or mission. These terms are not exactly interchangeable, but almost. Mission is a term used, of course, a lot in the religious context. And that's about a valid mission, valid and appealing mission or purpose. Leadership is about shared values, basing action on shared values that underpin the vision, the purpose or mission, and indeed the strategies, which is the fourth theme or practice of leadership, strategy. Leadership is also about strategy. Showing the way is one thing, how you proceed along the way to a destination is another thing, and that's what strategy is all about, how you do that. And empowerment is the fifth theme, and we're going to concentrate on empowerment and the sixth theme, practice, engagement. Empowerment is about making sure that people are empowered to be able to do what needs to be done in all sorts of ways. A little bit more about that later. And the final theme, which is perhaps even more important in relation to our subject of spiritual well-being, is engagement. That people are engaged. That effective leaders influence, motivate, and inspire people to want to do what needs to be done. Or they make sure that people are motivated and inspired to do what needs to be done. Now that doesn't necessarily mean doing things to them. It means creating the environment and the opportunities and so on in which people become engaged. And I'm probably sounding a little bit idealistic there in terms of business organisations, but why not? We have another problem in terms of definition. I don't know what your views on this are, but there are many definitions of spirituality. what I've done on the second bullet point here is conglomerate the ideas I've got from dictionaries. So I've started off with a great etymological source, which is the dictionaries. And spirituality seems to be, they say, concerns what relates to or affects the emotions, character of a person in relation to mood, courage, determination, and energy, motivation, if you like. Well, in sum, a person's animating force or spirit, the animating force. In my research, which is secondary research, feel it concerns a synergy based on values and beliefs that integrates meaning, a perception of meaning, a feeling of meaning, purpose, a sense of belongingness, community perhaps, and a sense of value or worth in what you're doing, that it is really worthwhile. And that animates us in our lives. It animates in what we seek to do, or seek, and actually how we actually behave, what we actually do. I developed that in terms of the workplace to concern the motivation or driving force that is uniquely human in seeking, providing, or fulfilling, depending on your point of view in a particular context, a need or desire for meaning, purpose, sense of belonging, and a sense of value or worth. And this actually is consistent with Maslow's hierarchy of needs and self-actualization theory, interestingly enough, just as an aside. Now this can take, in my opinion, a humanistic or secular form, or it can relate to a transcendent higher power, a religious form. I think it's generally true to say that research has shown, in general, with perhaps some exceptions, that spirituality can help people to maintain good mental health and well-being. I think this is probably more strongly true of mental health, emotional health, and so on, than perhaps spiritual health. We can argue about that or discuss that perhaps. And of course, there is some evidence that people, according to Michael King, who was at UCL, Chris has heard me say, report this before I think, or comment on it, evidence that people who are spiritual but not religious are more prone to mental health problems than those who are spiritual and religious, and indeed those who are neither, which is interesting, because it doesn't quite gel with a lot of other research that has been done. So it seems as though the position, the situation is not crystal clear at the moment. Nevertheless, spirituality is something we need to explore. And in fact, the Mental Health Foundation reports of how spirituality, expressing it in our own way, exploring spirituality, these are basic human rights. Interestingly, we can look at workplace spirituality in terms of person environment fit, work done by John Milliman and others. The fit between a person and the job, person in the group of which he or she is a member, and indeed the person in the organisation. It's quite a useful way of looking at it, I think, and you can see I've identified certain elements of spirituality and how they relate to Milliman's categories. Leaders encourage a sense of collective identity and collective efficacy, which brings feelings, stronger feelings of self-worth and efficiency. According to James Monroe Burns, one of the most eminent leadership scholars, who was a political scientist and historian of great note, he wrote a book which is a seminal book that everybody should read, published in 1978, simply called Leadership. And he's written biographies of American presidents and many other things. A wonderful writer and thinker, actually. This enhances a sense of meaningfulness in one's life, of course. Burns quotes Bernard Bass, an eminent leadership scholar, alas, no longer with us, and he was a close personal friend of mine, and we had many conversations about this. It also includes a sense of community. And Margaret McKee has done some empirical research on that, establishing that link. Incidentally, in relation to this sense of community or belongingness, feeling disconnected from colleagues, work colleagues, being disconnected from the social aspects of work, in other words, can adversely affect well-being at work. For example, remote working in the virtual organisation, and indeed even pot desking, that many of us are perhaps familiar with in academia. I certainly am, as a visiting prof. Very pathetic. You don't have that sense of belonging or connectedness, and that can be an adverse factor. Pull it towards me, I must remember next time. Now, spirituality does have a dark side. Like so many concepts in my world of work, And in fact, Peter Case and Jonathan Causal, and particularly Dennis Tourish, have written extensively about this, that spirituality at work has been exploited, we can say commercially, if you like, in business organisations, where employers seek domination and control, according to these commentators. You know, making more money, this is just another way of making more money. Let's introduce spirituality at work. It might just increase the margins a little bit in the bottom line. It has led to quite a lot of distrust and disgust, cynicism and so on with management. And indeed, disengagement rather than engagement. It's quite a paradox, isn't it, really? And there are so many other examples of that, like mindfulness and meditation and total quality control, and empowerment, and so on. All these concepts that came into being have been exploited, in fact. And in fact, Karen Holland and colleagues asked the question, how do we best impart spiritual meaning without imposing one's religious beliefs or on others, or one's own personal beliefs, perhaps from a business commercial perspective. I think Gomez and Fisher provide quite a useful general concept of spiritual well-being, a state of being that reflects positive feelings, behaviours and cognitions in terms of relationships with yourself, with others, of course, with nature in general. Spirituality has connections with nature and our attitudes and perceptions and feelings towards nature, indeed with the transcendent also, and this provides a sense of identity, wholeness, satisfaction, positive things like joy and contentment and beauty and respect and so on and so forth. That's quite a sort of all-encompassing concept of spiritual well-being from them. If I translate that into what we're talking about today, we can say that spiritual well-being can well be characterized as a state of well-being concerning positive feelings, behaviors and cognitions in relationships with one's workplace, specifically all to do with one's workplace, you know, the organization we work with, your boss, the people in your group that you're responsible for, and so on and so forth, in respect of meaning, purpose, belonging, and value or worth at work. Viktor Frankl was very, very affected, probably an understatement, of his experience of Auschwitz in the Second World War, which he survived. He's a psychiatrist. Some of you may be familiar with his work and his writings. And he's very much focused on meaning, finding meaning, and finding meaning in life as a motivational force. He says it is the primary motivational force. We can argue with that, but certainly it is a strong motivational force, of course. And I've illustrated, I've commented on that earlier by talking about how many middle managers in business organizations, for example, are asking, you know, why am I doing this? You know, what the devil am I doing? psychological, perhaps it overlaps with spiritual well-being, is characterized as having a sense of purpose and meaning and positive emotions, according to Ian Robertson and Kerry Cooper. Kerry Cooper is well known in this field, in fact, this field of work. And well-being associated generally with purpose in life. Purpose in life plays an important part. Spiritual meaning enhances well-being, and of course purpose, values and goals contribute to that. Meaningfulness of work is determined by several factors, the variety of skills that you use in your work, the range of skills and tasks that you perform. Variety is important. Task identity, the extent to which a person doing a job is able to complete a whole and identifiable piece of work that he or she can call his or her own. And task significance, the extent to which the job the person is performing has an impact on other people and their lives in a positive way in the organization or in general. Of course, these things, events, goals, the meaningfulness of these things is determined by values. I mean, your values, your personal values affect the kind of meaning you attach to such things, as well as your beliefs and needs. Kahn was the first person to write extensively about engagement from a scholarly point of view in 1990. And he identified meaningfulness as an antecedent of engagement, a necessary condition for it, or part of it. Gadi et al. Found that it's a mediator, in statistical terms, between leadership and engagement. In other words, meaningfulness is the route which leadership takes in engaging people. You know, so in other words, it's through engagement occurs through meaningfulness in leadership behavior. And it's associated with motivation and productivity. And that was written about quite a long time ago, about 30 years ago now. And with psychological well-being as well. So I have a couple of propositions which I'm continuing to explore. First of all, that employee spiritual well-being is a consequence of workplace leadership. And that's moderated by empowerment and mediated by workplace spirituality and engagement. In other words, the relationship between leadership and well-being is influenced by empowerment, the degree and type of empowerment, and it operates through spirituality, the relationship operates through spirituality and engagement. The second proposition is that spiritual leadership is an employee-centered form of leadership. Some leadership is not so employee-centered, that focuses on enabling people to experience meaning, purpose, belongingness, and positive feelings about the value and worth of what they do. Enabling people to experience this. It's not dumping it on them or, you know, telling them that's what the meaning and purpose is and get on with it. but it's helping people to discover this in their work. So there's a graphic model of my model of the relationship between leadership in the workplace and spiritual well-being. We have four of the core themes and practices here, and the other two are here. So you have vision, purpose, values, and strategy, which are influenced by the degree to which people are empowered to do what to do, which creates a sort of spirit, workplace spirituality. And spiritual leadership in the workplace is helping people to find meaning, purpose, a sense of belonging, and value or worth in what they do. And that operates through engagement as a result of workplace spirituality, engagement in work, to determine the extent of people's employees' spiritual well-being. More about employment, empowerment and engagement, of course, and women. I believe that workplace spirituality is particularly closely linked with employee empowerment and engagement, two core characteristics of leadership, as I said. Now, what is empowerment exactly? It's about giving people the knowledge, skills, self-confidence, opportunity, freedom, authority, and of course, resources. To manage themselves and be able to do what needs to be done. Engagement is the extent to which people are motivated or inspired to want to do willingly or even eagerly what needs to be done, and even give of their discretionary effort over and above that. So that's how engagement is generally defined, I think. Empowerment is a moderator, then. It's something that influences a relationship between leadership and workplace spirituality, and indeed engagement and spiritual well-being. There are various pieces of research that have illustrated that. Empowerment influences employee engagement, several pieces of research, and there's more. I'm still wading through stacks and stacks of articles reporting research in this area. And it's turned out to be a much larger task than I expected. Well, I'm delighted, actually. Keeps me occupied. there's a lot of research going on in this area. And the same for empowerment. A strategy, The Economist suggests it's a strategy for enhancing engagement by providing more meaningful work. Work is more meaningful when people feel empowered. Some examples. Toyota, who operate not too far from here, of course, encourage its employees to think of ways to improve operations, such as stopping the whole assembly line if they see something that needs fixing. So that's just a little example, of empowering your employees. Whole Foods have used employee teams to choose members of their teams and allocate or distribute tasks. And they rely on peer relations rather than top-down diktat or control. So they organize their own teams and they recruit and use their own members. Quality circles, or quality control circles, as they're known as usually in Asia, that I worked on actually a long time ago when I lived in Singapore for several years. These are self-help natural teams in the workplace that actually identify how they can make workplace improvements with the help of a skilled facilitator. So they have their supervisor or foreman, leading the team, but with a facilitator as well. And that was something borrowed from the Japanese, who in turn learned it from the Americans in the early 1950s, I think, but the Japanese sort of developed it considerably, and then a lot of other Asian countries started copying them. But it was a very empowering and engaging, even, but certainly empowering process, and it was quite enjoyable to see how wonderful people on the shop floor, or you know, at the sharp end, tills in retail stores, or waiters in restaurants and so on, could actually identify ways of improving what they're doing and contribute to the business improvement. Quite remarkable when you think that your managers are actually paying. Sometimes they supposedly do things like that. But it was very empowering and had tremendous benefits. So it was quite a popular movement, I think, in the 1980s generally, into the 90s. Those are some examples. Engagement. Oops. Well, a healthy organisation culture is characterised by having engaged employees. I think most of us wouldn't disagree with that. There is a positive correlation between engagement and organisational performance, as well as employee loyalty, productivity, and customer care. Daniel Goleman, a noted writer on emotional intelligence, writes about that. And employee engagement is demonstrated, of course, how do we recognise it? Demonstrated by what Shafley and others call absorption, dedication and vigour. This is how we recognise somebody who's engaged. Absorption, in the sense of, it's a cognitive dimension. About maintaining high levels of concentration and involvement. I'm sure all of you can think of times or situations when you have been completely absorbed in concentrating and being involved in a task, an activity. There are many examples, I suppose, like playing a piece of music, giving a lecture or presentation. writing, even, and so on and so forth. Dedication is another example. And this is more of an emotional dimension, showing high levels of involvement and enthusiasm, being obviously inspired, showing pride and rising to the challenge, and so on and so forth. And vigour, and that's more of a physical dimension, of course, showing high levels of physical energy, persistence, effort, and so on, despite setbacks and difficulties. I think that's quite a good analysis, really, of employee engagement. And of course, there's this concept of flow, you know, the idea that we get carried away, if you like, with what we're doing, because we're so involved and immersed in the subject matter, in what we're doing, such that you may miss lunch or dinner sometimes, or something like that, you know. employee engagement, David Guest suggests, is associated with well-being, and of course there's plenty of evidence to support that. It's interesting, and I've seen survey after survey produced, for example, by the Chartered Institute of Personnel and Development, which is a professional organisation for HR people in organisations, public and private sector and so on. Time after time I've seen research results showing that people are lacking engagement, they are even disengaged in what they do. This is perhaps the biggest driver of employee dissatisfaction at work and consequent turnover, moving somewhere else to get a bit more job satisfaction. But lack of engagement is a big issue, and perhaps a growing issue. I wonder if you disagree with this statement. Making money for the owners of a business, which is the purpose, never was motivating, inspiring, or engaging for its employees. Except if you work for John Lewis, Waitrose, I suppose. it's hard to actually feel inspired, isn't it? Working to fill the pockets of other people. Who you may or may not respect in the first place. I'm afraid it's a fact of life. why are people unengaged or even disengaged? Well, tomorrow, presidency actually suggests two reasons. First of all, organizations don't really understand what people want from work. Hard to argue with that, isn't it? Why is this the case? Well, bad management selection, you know, in terms of leadership, poor training and development, poor promotion practices, many things we can say, I can say from my own experience in these respects, experience at all in practice. Self-interest, perhaps, sycophancy, narcissism, another hot topic these days, and sheer lack of aptitude for leadership. Indeed, I often say this, meet with a sturdy reaction from some of my colleagues, those who need leadership development most are those who desire it least.
I think they've been born, you say they're born to lead, you say they don't need to be trained.
Yes, they're born to lead, yeah. Yes, that's right, yeah. It's natural, you can't train it. Mm. I remember, you know, when I was at Strathclyde University, I was actually working at a non-profit charitable foundation called the Leadership Trust, and I was a visiting prof there at Strathclyde. I'd been full-time before that and became part-time and joined the Leadership Trust. Anyway, one of my tasks was to introduce an MBA program with a specialism in leadership studies. And I remember letters to the press on this when it was announced, the press release and so on, and there was a reaction from one or two people who said, "What are you doing, wasting your time and money on MBA in leadership studies? Leadership can't be taught." You know, you're either a born leader or you're not. You know, you're a natural leader or not, which is patent nonsense, actually. Maybe you disagree. but it was quite staggering, really. That, you know, people who perhaps are somewhat narcissistic believe themselves to be brilliant leaders, you know. And some of them perhaps are, in one sense, if not most other more acceptable senses. There are causal links then. Well, are there causal links? It's a question. Between spirituality and spiritual well-being. Which causes which? It's not clear. Causality is not clear. There are associations, but we need more work to explore causality. Variations in the definition of spirituality and, of course, in its measurement as well. That's one issue that needs attention. Evidence that an agreeable temperament and sociability may be the key personal characteristics that predispose people to be spiritually orientated, and that these characteristics, rather than spirituality itself, contribute to well-being. And also, evidence that the benefits associated with spirituality might be largely due to being a member of a close-knit community, you know, one that works well, and so on. So, spirituality just may be a consequence rather than a cause of spiritual well-being. More well needed. Meaningfulness of work is associated positively with psychological well-being. Others, amongst others, have demonstrated that. Engagement is associated with employee job satisfaction. Again, that's not surprising. Job satisfaction is not necessarily the same as well-being, of course. Your well-being may be part of it. And one particular feature of engagement, known as affective commitment, which is actually one's emotional attachment to an organization, for one reason or another, is a direct predictor of psychological well-being. You know, a positive relationship there. Now, what about spiritual leadership? I've talked about leadership. What about spiritual leadership? I've said that leadership is showing the way and helping or inducing people to pursue it. Spiritual leadership, then, is defined by Lewis Fry and colleagues, for example, and I think he in particular, has produced a robust model of spiritual leadership that Mai Vu, sitting over there, is using in her research, in fact. And according to Lewis Fry, Jody Fry, which is a familiar name, it involves intrinsically motivating rather than extrinsic fear, I guess, and inspiring workers through hope, faith, and a vision of service to key stakeholders, and a corporate culture characterized by values of altruistic love to produce a highly motivated, effective, productive workforce. He very much sets the idea of spiritual leadership in an organizational context, you know, where you have objectives about being productive and so on and so forth. Spiritual leadership can serve both an organization's needs for effectiveness, and all organizations need to be effective, in however that's measured, and employees' psychological needs, according to Steger. No form of effective moral leadership, I would argue, coerces people to change or compromise deeply held personal values and beliefs. Now, that raises the question about those values and beliefs, of course. And there are values and beliefs held very deeply by people that some of us would regard as very bad, evil, in fact. And I think you can probably think of some examples yourselves. Instead, true spiritual leadership enables people to find meaning, purpose, belongingness, and a sense of value or worth in their work, not imposing this on them, or indeed ignoring it. I would contend that. This contributes to spiritual well-being and happiness and lives as a whole. Margaret McKee did some very important research, which I find particularly absorbing and interesting, in the Canadian healthcare setting. And I know that people who come to these seminars are often involved in healthcare, one way or another. And this found a significant relationship between leadership and employees' mental and spiritual well-being. Right. This relationship was mediated by workplace spirituality. In particular, one aspect of spirituality that I mentioned earlier, a sense of community, belongingness. Margaret McKee says, leaders influence individual well-being through their ability to enhance people's sense of community in the workplace, particularly, not exclusively, but particularly. Michael King, mentioned him earlier, suggests that spiritual experience should not be conflated with its outcomes, because that ruins the research, essentially, the empirical research. What I'm trying to do in my model is to overcome that confusion by suggesting that it's the discovery or revelation of inspirational meaning, meaning that inspires people, and purpose, and belongingness, and value, sense of value and worth, and empowerment to be able to do it. I define that as a spiritual experience that determines engagement in the form of wanting to do it and exercise discretionary effort in doing so. That's outcome. So, you know, I'm trying to avoid this conflation between spiritual experience and spiritual outcomes. And the same relationship or same argument holds for leadership and spirituality and engagement and spiritual well-being and indeed happiness. Happiness, enjoyment, pleasure, joy, fulfillment, contentment. There's more evidence from a company in the Netherlands. Several companies, 69 companies actually, found that leadership was positively related to work engagement, so a positive relationship, we speculate a causal one, and in turn to job performance generally. And indeed, leadership and employee work engagement are positively associated, and the relationship between leadership and performance is mediated by engagement. So we're getting a kind of complex complexity of research findings here. Adding up to something. Leadership style affects organizational performance, but it does so, according to some of the research, through its effect on employee well-being. So well-being is a route to organizational performance, employee well-being. Now, some issues needing attention. Relationships between spirituality and well-being have not been found in some studies. Undergraduates are a bit of a dicey sample, I think. it's not a, you know, it's not a 100% record in terms of findings here, and in terms of these two studies mentioned here, there are methodological issues which would perhaps undermine those studies anyway, and therefore discount that issue. But it needs to be explored a bit more. Also, inconsistencies in research findings on the connection between spirituality and well-being. Now here, there is a factor that may be confounding this research, and that is this relationship, and that is personality, individual endpoint, personality. A preference, for example, this research found that a preference for intuitive thinking or cognition rather than analytical thinking or cognition exerts an important influence in any salutogenic effects from spirituality or religiosity. Salutogenic in terms of what contributes to well-being. We need to explore that a little bit more. You know, what is it that may be confounding some of these studies? How important is personality indeed? Many studies have produced artificially high associations and you know, some exciting relationships in the research. But you know, one problem here is having common items that are common items in the research questionnaires using spiritual well-being scales to test the effect of spirituality on well-being, for example. So you're getting an obvious correlation, if not 100%. High ratings of spiritual well-being may mask negative aspects of life that come out through an interview, a narrative there, these high ratings lack empirical evidence, really. So how people say they feel good, if you like, spiritually, might be actually very biased and self-deluded. As Michael King says, we need to adopt the same rigorous standards in studies of spirituality that are usual in scientific method. And that perhaps will be further developments. Watch this space, I suppose, for the future. Another issue is what needs to be. Who is responsible for employees' spiritual well-being at work? And what needs to be done? And by whom? Well, here's some research from the CIPD published last month that suggests that 53%, if you add up the ineffective scores, it's 53% here and 53% there, actually, in terms of empowering others and employee engagement, are unsatisfactory areas. So HR professionals are identifying empowerment and engagement as areas in which their companies are somewhat or very ineffective. Interestingly, only 40% say that's a major need over the next 3 years, even though 53% say it's ineffective to varying extents. And this is, by the way, equal across public and private sectors, both sectors. There's no significant difference between them, interestingly. I've actually found in other research that the public sector scores rather badly compared with the private sector in many areas related to this field. On average, there is a bit of a difference. The third sector, the charity sector, non-profit sector, actually comes out best, generally speaking, in terms of employee well-being and so on. But this was just public and private sectors. One view on who is responsible for employee spiritual well-being at work is themselves. Employees themselves can take responsibility by using Buddhist principles in coping with these difficulties, conflict, stress, discouragement, frustration, and so on and so forth in the workplace, focusing on honesty, openness, courage, maturity, learning, and so on and so forth, in gaining clarity and wisdom and inspiration. So that's one answer in terms of self-help. However, organizations do have a responsibility, of course, for what they do with people that they employ. And action really from the top level down including the HR function, which I think has an important part to play in this area. HR policies that do focus on the salutogenic factors, in fact. And employers' policies and actions, we see them reported. If you read the Quality Press, as I do every day, I read reports of companies introducing schemes to do with well-being of employees and so on and so forth. Tesco introduced one called the Health Pledge recently, and you know Tesco's motto, don't you? Every little helps. Well, one employee in the sample said, no, very little helps. Action by leaders and managers, individually and collectively, especially to treat the causes rather than merely the consequences of lack of well-being at work. So much is done to treat the consequences. Well, not that much, but you know, much more is done to treat the consequences of lack of well-being and you know, dysfunctional stress, for example, and so on and so forth. And it's the causes that we really need to get at and address. And of course, attention to empowerment and engagement as our strategies as well. So, attention to employee empowerment means enhancing people's, for example, Maria Hudson says from ACAS, the Arbitration and Conciliation Service in the world of work, attention to employees' own decision-making and control, as in, for example, Toyota, as a case example, over their role and how they deliver work. Engagement can be attended to. An example is the struggling NHS at the present time. Kerry Cooper himself was speaking at a conference, I think very shortly, in Edinburgh on this subject, says that with the excessive staff shortages and high workloads, staff engagement needs to be focused on. And in fact, Michael West from the CIPD says compassionate leadership and compassionate care needs to be the core element of leadership strategy. Leadership that inspires excessive employee engagement is an issue, and that's a big subject in its own right. That people are over-engaged stressed in a dysfunctional way that leads to ill health, physically, and perhaps mentally, and emotionally too. And that's likely, that sort of excessive engagement. An example, let me take an example. The example might be working in the city. Goldman Sachs is a famous company in the financial sector that pays extremely high, provides extremely high earnings to successful people, traders and investment bankers and so on and so forth. And they become so wrapped up in the culture of achievement and high earnings, as obviously a very tasty carrot, that it leads to burnout, stress and other dysfunctional aspects of human nature. And that's a good example, really, where it can rebound or backfire. Many people do get burned out, you know, in the city culture, as an example. Obviously, the result can be increased absence due to sickness, breakdowns, and so on. So, excessive engagement, caution. So, conclusions. Spiritual well-being is both instrumental for organisation effectiveness, however you define or and measure it, and it's also a socially and morally responsible and desirable end in itself. That's one of the things I've come to. Workplace spirituality is causally related in certain ways, and we need to clarify that, to employee spiritual well-being. Spiritual leadership creates workplace spirituality and ultimately spiritual well-being, partly, but I believe significantly, through employee empowerment and engagement. And we need to further help, or to use my word, induce employers to enhance leadership in particular spiritual leadership in their organizations. Implications of those conclusions? We need to attend to leadership and leadership development policy and practice as part of improved HR policies and practice. We need to make sure that vision is clearly and validly clearly defined and is valid and appealing. When I say valid, I mean one that makes sense, a vision for the future. Ensure that the same is true of a mission or purpose. People understand it, that it's valid, it makes sense, it's appealing, even inspiring itself. People join organizations because of the purpose of their organization. Certainly, that's why they joined in the first place in many cases. We need to ensure that shared values that support the vision, purpose and strategies of our organizations, to pursue them, are identified, communicated and personally displayed by people in leadership positions. They are showing the way. How do you do that? Well, in part, by behaving that way. And we need to ensure that rational strategies that are informed by these shared values are also put into practice, or communicated and actually put into practice. Again, many leaders leave strategy to other people. They have the vision and the sense of purpose and so on, and strategy is somebody else's for him, but that's every leader's role as well. We need to ensure that people are empowered so that they may find meaning, purpose, belongingness, and a sense of value in their work, so that they are able to do what needs to be done. And likewise, that they're engaged with their work, motivated, even inspired, to want to do what needs to be done, and will do so willingly, eagerly even, to give their discretionary effort over and above that. And not into the realms of high stress or anything like that, of course, it's dysfunctional. Stress is good in certain ways. Too much stress or the wrong kind of stress, not so bad. And we need to ensure that employees' well-being, physical, mental, and spiritual, is maintained, and where necessary or possible, of course, enhanced through an ethical and spiritual approach to leadership. Thank you. Thank you.